and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q2 FY 2022 earnings conference call of Cyient Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Krishna Bodanapu, MD and CEO. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Cyient Limited's earnings call for the second quarter of financial year 2022. I am Krishna Bodanapu, Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Cyient. Present with me on this call are Mr. Ajay Aggarwal, the Executive Director and Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Karthik Natarajan, the Executive Director and Chief Operating Officer. Before we begin, I would like to mention that some of the statements made in today's discussions may be forward-looking in nature and may involve risks and uncertainties. A detailed statement in this regard is available in our investor update, which has been emailed to you and is also available on our website. This call will be accompanied with an earnings call presentation. Details of the same have already been shared with you. With this, let me take you through the highlights for the quarter. In U.S. dollar terms, we posted a revenue of $150.1 million, which was a growth of 11.2% YoY and 5.6% QoQ in constant currency. In rupee terms, we posted a quarterly revenue of INR 1,112 crores. This signifies a growth of 10.8% YoY and 5.1% QoQ. Services revenue stood at $124.6 million, a growth of 9.2% YoY, 5.5% QoQ in constant currency, or 4.5% in dollar terms. Workforce Delta, which was an acquisition, contributed to about 0.5% of this growth. DLM revenue stood at $25.5 million, a growth of 22.3% YoY and 5.4% QoQ. Group EBIT margin stood at 14%, up 301 basis points year-on-year or 90 basis points QoQ. In the last seven years, this is the highest EBIT margin that we have delivered. Free cash flow generation or free cash generation for the quarter was at INR 2,050 million or 205 crores, a conversion of 97% on EBITDA and, of course, 169% or so on PAT. Finally, PAT stood at 121.3 crores or 1,213 million for the quarter. This is a growth of 44.7% YoY or 5.5% quarter-on-quarter, and this also is among the highest cash that we have delivered purely from operations. Coming to the highlights for the quarter, we strengthened our digital solution suite, which we have branded as IntelliCyient, through the acquisition of Workforce Delta. Workforce Delta is a consulting company with expertise in advising and executing workforce management programs for companies globally. This acquisition is in line with our strategic path of enabling digital transformation for our clients through the IntelliCyient framework. We expanded our digital solutions portfolio for the aerospace industry with PPAP for Aero, which is a global AS9145, which is an aerospace certification supplier compliance software framework. Microsoft Azure ITAR is again the compliance framework for aerospace and defense in the U.S. The ITAR compliant SaaS cloud app and global support services solutions reduce costs while ensuring the quality of manufactured parts for aerospace. Again, with the anticipated ramp-up and what's happening in aerospace, this positions our digital offering for aerospace very well. We were recognized as a rising star in the Connected Mobility Consulting and Services in the ISG Provider Lens Internet of Things Services and Solutions study. We enhanced our additive manufacturing solutions with the implementation of an SLM 280 system in Florida. The additive manufacturing is again a key aspect of digital offerings for us, given that a number of our customers are very high precision, high-end manufacturing companies. The ability for them to manufacture just in time, especially for aftermarket replacement parts and prototype, become very, very important. And therefore, this is a key element of our digital offering. And this is a system that actually is quite unique in the sense that it has the ability to create parts from five different metals, say like titanium, magnesium, of course, steel alloys, and so on and so forth. We achieved select peer status in the Amazon Web Services partner network. This partnership differentiates Cyient as a provider of specialized demonstrated technology proficiency and customer success. We also joined the TM Forum to collaborate with global service providers. The TM Forum is a forum of 850 members, including 10 of the world's largest telecom service providers. And we will become a member of a very small group within that, which helps define the future of networking standards, technologies, etc. We continue to significantly strengthen the management team. I'm also very happy and proud to announce that Rajneesh Kinney joined us as the Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer. Rajneesh will lead the technology development at Cyient and be responsible for our technology vision, building competency, and the relevant and market-ready solutions. And Rajneesh comes with a lot of background in engineering and R&D. I'm quite confident that with his leadership in place, we will continue to accelerate our solution development into the future and for many years to come. With this, I would like to hand the call over to Mr. Ajay Agarwal, who will take you through the detailed financial performance for the quarter. Thank you, and over to you, Ajay.
Thank you, Krishna. At the beginning, let me say it's a well-rounded performance that we have got in this quarter, in line with our anticipation. On all the lines, revenue, profit, and cash, I will talk about all three of them. I think it's quite a well-rounded performance. Let me start by talking about the revenue. As Krishna said, we have $150.1 million as the total revenue in this quarter. And quarter on quarter, if you look at the constant currency growth, it's about 5.6%. What we have got from our new acquisition, Workforce Delta, that we had announced, that has been about $900,000 or 0.7% of the revenue. That's also included on this. In terms of the DLM, also, I think we have a similar growth of about 5.4%, and we have clocked $25.5 million. And the way we are looking at, I'm sure Karthik will talk about it, the way we are looking at the demand, the order intake, and the pipeline, we are very confident of being able to continue this growth traction. And it is quite well-rounded. You may see a little blip in the EMEA, but that's because of some cyclicity of orders in DLM. On the services side, the EMEA is also positive. In terms of our profitability, this has been extremely, extremely gratifying quarter for us, and this is really in some ways, you know, whatever we have been trying to do to improve our margin. We have clocked 14% as the EBIT margin, which is about 90 bps higher quarter on quarter and 301 bps higher year on year. What has happened in terms of margin is that, you know, we have got extremely good set of operational improvements that have come in. We have got the benefit of the growth, which has also kicked in. And we are confident that from all the parameters which are building up to this kind of 14% margin, which also includes for services 15.5%, I think that structural cost structure, the structural build-up to be able to continue to be 15.5% margin in this year and get back to 17% in the next 2 years, that's very much there. In terms of DLM, we have done about 6.8% as the margin. The profit after tax, as Krishna said, is 121.3 crore or 1213 million INR. And this is an increase of 5.5% quarter on quarter and 44% year on year. Our earliest highest profit also included some of the one-offs, including the government and things like that. So it's very close to, we are getting quite close to, you know, what we have done in the past, and we will see the journey from here. will be the new milestones only. That there are no surprises. We are doing well in line with what we had anticipated and what we had carried for. In terms of, I'll let you read the EBIT bridge. We have provided you what exactly has happened. Primarily, I think company is focused on the operational improvements. We are also letting go of some revenue. You would see that our offshoring is moving very nicely. I think in the last 4-6 quarters, we have moved about 6% in offshoring. Currently, we are at about 52% of offshoring, and we are continuing to see that offshoring will improve. We are also that also creates a little bit of headwind on the revenue, but our focus is on profitability. We are also trying to see that how can we let go of some of the less profitable business. So all these initiatives are really helping us. In terms of the headwinds, I would say there are two things which are happening. One is looking at the whole dynamics in the market and the attrition rates. We continue to make sure that we are providing, differentiated merit increases. And we'll continue to do some of it in quarter three and quarter four also. And we are also making sure that Krishna talked about this technology landscape, the new chief technology officer joining us. And we continue to invest about 1 to 1.5% of our revenue into the investment. Last comment I would make is that if you look at this margin, this is after bringing in some expenses like travel and other overheads, which were not novel at the sort of in the earlier quarter. But we are also making sure that we are back to normal training, normal retention initiatives, the normal investments in the business, and they will be continuing.
The person you are speaking with has put your call on hold. Please stay on the line.
So you may please go ahead.
Hi, Jenny. Can you check with everyone? They can hear us?
Yes, sir. This disturbance was from Mr. Reddy's line. I've just currently muted him. You may please go ahead.
Thank you. Sorry for the disturbance, guys. So what I'm saying is that, this tailwinds, we will continue in the next 2 quarters, and headwinds will also remain in terms of making sure we have the retention of people and we have some investments in technology in the coming quarters. In terms of the free cash flow, which is coming up, we have a cash balance of 1,403 crores. I think this is the highest that we have done. And we have done extremely good conversion in this quarter. We did have a muted quarter one, but if you look at overall for H1, we have we have clocked 70% plus kind of conversion, and we will continue to have that kind of conversion. One thing I want to mention is we have really got a good reduction of about 9 days in our DSO, and we are confident that not only we will sustain it, we will further improve it. With this, I hand over the call to Karthik for the business update.
Thank you, Ajay. Thank you, Krishna. Good evening, everyone. And I hope all of you are safe and healthy. And I just want to start off by saying that I hope you remember your company has announced an organization structure at the same time last year, around October. And we said we are really structuring ourselves as transportation, communication, utility, and portfolio of sectors. And I think that's really playing off. In terms of what we expected the portfolio of sectors to be the fastest growing and followed by communication and utilities and by transport due to the challenges that we have seen on aerospace. And also from a broad-based demand driver standpoint, I think engineering and R&D probably is in a cusp of secular long-term growth, aided by the sustainability, which is around the 2050 carbon neutral program. I think everybody wants to accelerate that. I don't think we as a community can wait till 2050. It has to be accelerated at least by a decade. And also followed by the supply chain disruptions caused by semiconductor. I think that's really creating a significant opportunities for players like us. And third is, of course, the digital transformation. I think this is definitely on steroids, and we are really seeing a growth on the digital as we started setting up a dedicated business unit last year. So remember that we have shared the same thing around the same time last year. And also followed by hyper-connectivity. I think the world would be a lot more connected, and thanks to fiber and 5G. And I think pandemic has taught all of us how a lot of things can be done remotely with e-commerce growing. I think people can be connected to supply and demand irrespective of all of them need to be at the same place. I think this is going to drive a significant amount of investments, especially in US and other geographies, on the connectivity part. And having said that, our current performance on Q2, and if you look at transportation, has shown a 2.6% quarter-on-quarter growth. And if you look at the third column on the left, from the left, and aerospace has come back to growth trajectory, like what we have said. It is not in a hyper-growth mode, but at least it started coming back as compared to what we thought about a year ago, and this is a good sign. And communication and utilities continue to grow, and we are confident that this will grow double-digit for year-on-year, as you can see, about 12.5% that you are seeing as of Q2. And portfolio of sectors, I think this is where the acceleration is happening, and aided by semiconductor, automotive, medical devices, mining, I think all of them are seeing all-round growth. I think that's definitely visible in terms of what we have seen in Q2. And overall, we have grown about 11.2% year-on-year in Q2, as compared to 9.9% that we have shown in Q1, which is definitely an acceleration that we are seeing on the one side. And also, we have talked about setting up the large green factory. We are still halfway through, and we started seeing some early green shoots. And we are close to about 16 of 63.5 million, and 4 from services, and 1 from BLM, and 1 from what we call them as a build-to-spec, which is the engineering to manufacturing. And that's something which is definitely an early signal that we will be able to win a lot more deals on the B2S side. So if you really start getting down to specific verticals and communication and utilities, I think this is definitely going to be on the hyper-connected world that we are talking about. And we will see investments across all the networks, and especially in AM and Europe. And also, as you would have seen the TM Forum and other investment that we are making, I think it is definitely starting to pay off. And we also set out a network transformation led by technology. I think that's going to be our growth trajectory for the next 2 to 5 years. And we are also recognized by Peak Metrics from Everest Group as a 5G contender. I think that's definitely a great recognition from analysts. And many of our investments around the private wireless and technology transformation for networks, I think all of them are paying out as we anticipated. Utilities have definitely started coming back to the party, and which is a good sign. And we have been able to work on some of the cloud-native next-generation spatial information system, and we have been able to bring in data transformation, system integration kind of projects. And we are continuing to see a momentum from the utility side across UK, Australia, as well as in North America. DLM has seen a quarter-on-quarter growth, and we talked about last quarter there was a specific issue, but I think it is joining the growth trajectory as we anticipated. The supply constraints continue to be a challenge, and due to the semiconductor or some of the electronic components. But I think this is definitely on a robust growth trajectory as we expected. Transportation, I think aerospace, I'm sure this question is definitely going to come. How are you seeing the aerospace growth? And I think the domestic travel has come back to 70 to 75%, and which is still patchy globally. For example, US could be about 85-90%, and Europe could be about 70-75%, and the rest of Asia could be around 60-65%. But the intercontinental flights have still not come back, and they are still less than 50%. I think both are important for the industry to come back to growth trajectory. We started seeing some early green shoots, and we hope it continues to grow for us in the next 2-3 quarters. And rail, we have seen some of the couple of customer-specific issues, and that's the reason why we have seen a negative growth for this quarter. But I think we are confident that we should be able to really get this issue fixed in the next 2-3 quarters. Portfolio of services, as you can imagine, the medical devices and technology, I think this is going to be, again, a high growth segment for us. And we are confident that we'll see more than 20% growth in this particular segment, though it is small. But we are confident that this is going to be an area that we are strengthening, and across digital, embedded, and the design-led manufacturing areas. And semiconductors, and this is going to see a patchy growth, and we are seeing huge demand. We are also constrained by supply, and we are trying to see how do we balance it out. And due to the semiconductor glut that we've seen in the last 12 months, it's likely to continue for 2 more years, and that is creating some new demand, and we are trying to prepare ourselves to address this demand. And we are confident that this will also start seeing more than double-digit growth for the year. So continuing on the portfolio sectors, automotive and off-highway, and I think driven by the sustainability I talked about, which is the electrification. And two-thirds of the new vehicles sold will be electric, and we are close to one of the last EVs this quarter, and which is again on the electric platform customer. And we're very interested to look at disrupting the whole electric vehicle platforms, and we'll share more details as we start getting to get the confirmation from the customer to talk about it. And continuing to see momentum across mining and natural resources, and this is one of the acquisitions that, if you remember, we have done with IG Partners. I think that's really playing off well, and we are seeing the growth from both consulting and engineering services as well as on the digital transformation. I think this is a sector which will continue to grow at more than 40-50% year on year. Geospatial, and barring one customer, I think this has seen about 15% growth, but still, this is yet to get into the growth trajectory, and probably rail and geospatial are the two segments which has to really start getting into the growth trajectory as we exit this financial year. So with that, I would just summarize saying that I think we have a good organization structure and the leadership team in place, and we have a great strategy, and we started talking about pillars of growth, and interestingly, our pillars of growth, which is about 1/4 of our revenue, is growing at 30%. And if you're able to get that to about 1/3 of our business growing at 30%, I think that will really help us to confidently say that we'll start seeing a double-digit growth for the next few years. So that's what I will really summarize.
Thank you, Sandeep. So, thank you, Karthik. If I may just give a quick outlook for the rest of the year, we continue to expect that the services business will grow in double digit for the year. We have a line of sight to that, and the mathematics also supports that, that we will have good growth in Q3 also. As you know, that Q3 is a little bit of a challenge for us because of number of working days, but this time around we're quite confident that the demand that is there and the ramp-ups that have happened, that challenge will be overcome. Of course, like for like, there will be a dip in the capacity, which will have put a little bit of pressure on margin, because now for the same person, we have fewer number of days that we can be productive. But that's a point-in-time thing. But overall, as a company, we are confident that we will grow quite nicely in Q3 and, of course, in double-digit for the year. DLM will be in the range of 15-20%. We do continue to have some significant supply chain challenges there. So there's a little bit of a right shift that is now impacting us, and that's why we're a little bit muted there, but we're very confident it will be in that 15-20% range. For the year, we expect margins to improve by at least 300 basis points compared to 200 that we've talked about or that we saw at the beginning of the year. Like I said, there's still some interesting dynamics at play, given that attrition is also something that is of concern. We will have to relook at our salary structures, or we are relooking at our salary structures, et cetera, as we speak. Therefore, and also, like I said, you know, in while overall there will be growth in Q3, per-person productivity or per-person availability of capacity actually comes down, and therefore that also puts a bit of pressure on margin. That's why we are quite confident that we will do at least 300 basis points, and the margins will, you know, we believe that in the current steady state, and I'll explain that, but in the current steady state, margins are between 13.5% and 14%. Of course, this quarter we were at the higher end of that range, and will continue to be there for the rest of the year within that range. So these are good, sustainable margins. We also believe that once there's a little bit more stability that comes to the recruiting side of the market, margins will then further increase. But also, I want to say the services margins are looking quite good at about 16%, and we will continue within that range for the rest of the year. Other income will be in line with previous years, and the effective tax rate will be around in this 25-26% range. So overall, net-net, I think we're going to have a reasonably good year, a reasonably strong year on growth, but of course a very strong year on profitability and we're quite confident that we have the line of sight towards these numbers for the rest of the year. With that, I'll hand it back to the moderator to moderate the questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sandeep Shah from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Hello, yeah. Sandeep.
Yeah. Thanks for the opportunity and congrats on a good margin execution as well as great turnaround. Just the question in terms of, I think we are saying services revenue growth will continue at a double digit. So in that scenario,
sorry, we're not able to hear you very well. We're not able to hear you very well.
Is it clear now?
Yeah, this is better.
Yeah. Thanks. So just the question in terms of the services business growth. So I think we are reiterating a double-digit growth. So I believe this is in US dollar terms, and that requires close to a 4% compounded Q on Q. So you still believe that despite furloughs, we can achieve this run rate as a whole, or you believe 4Q could be heavy lifting and 3Q could be slightly softer as a whole? And question in terms of margins, are we saying the second half at consol level could be between 13% and 14%? What could be the tailwinds and the headwinds which could be there? And at services, I think what I get to understand for the second half, we are guiding for close to 16% range as a whole.
Okay, let me try to answer that. I'm sorry, but it wasn't very clear again, but let me try to answer that. On the growth of services, we continue to be confident. You're right. I mean, Q3 has a bit of a headwind with the number of working days, etc. But also, that's being quite negated by the number of new people that we're adding. That is the capacity increase. Like I said, the challenge is really in the capacity per person because number of working days. But total capacity, we are actually hiring quite aggressively. And of course, it is a difficult market, and therefore we have to be a little bit prudent. We're still giving up a few percent of growth every quarter because of the supply side challenges, but we'll park that aside. But net to your question, though, to answer your question, we are quite confident that we will hit double digit for the year based on the demand, based on what is going on at the moment. Also on the margin, I'll say, you know, for the year, we're saying 300 basis points will be improvement in margin. But really, the 13.5 to 14 is the range that we will be for the rest of the year. I mean, we started off a little bit pessimistically. We've done much better. But there are a couple of headwinds that we will start to run into. First is that there is some degree of normalcy that's returning. So some of the costs around travel, around marketing, around events, etc., are coming back. That's one a relatively small event. But more importantly, one is we will have to do one more round of salary corrections. I wouldn't say one more round of hikes in general, because I think we will do it in a nuanced manner so it doesn't doesn't put things out of control. But we will have to do one more level of at least corrections, which will have an impact. The second thing is we also continue to invest quite aggressively. I mean, I think one of the things that I'll also point out, and perhaps Karthik will talk in a little bit more detail, is if you look at our growth has really come from some of the newer technologies and areas that we focus on. We call it the five pillars of growth, and the two obvious ones there, the digital and embedded software. That's where a lot of our growth is coming, and that combination of that business is growing almost 30% year on year. Which means that now it's also, I think we have to face up and say that, look, we were a little bit late to some of these technologies and some of this game, but we're really catching on, and it's now given us a lot of confidence that we are going to be very, very strong players. You know, even the acknowledgement from ISG, who are leaders in technology or in ranking technology companies, we are a strong player now. And it's given us a lot of confidence that we should continue to aggressively invest in building technology, building capability, capacity, bring the right people for the newer areas, which is what we'll continue to do in Q2. So a combination of normalcy returning, salary adjustments, and investments are the headwinds that we're going to face.
Yeah, this is helpful. Just last few quarters, we were highlighting there is a scarcity of talent for us in terms of a digital engineering. So can you give us some color in terms of how are we making sure that those things does not occur? So what are the plans in terms of reskilling, upskilling on digital engineering as a whole?
Yeah, so I think the shortage of the digital and embedded software, that part of the equation continues. I think, but having said that, though, we are getting a lot more, or we're getting a lot better at one, creating our own supply, that is reskilling people, upskilling people, taking people with maybe half the capability, but spending, 3, 4, 6 months on training them. I think that's one. The second thing is, it's in this business, it also is a virtuous cycle in the sense that if we get the right kind of people, then we can hire better people and more people. And I think we're also in that virtuous cycle now because we've built a reasonable sort of seed team, and therefore we're able to attract better people. And the third thing is, I think we're also able to go to different sources, not just the traditional sources of either laterals or freshers, but also, train people, get people with similar backgrounds, but then be able to, get them on with the right training, etc. So that's helped. I don't want to say we are out of the woods yet. I think there's still a lot of pressure on these skills. And like I said, we're giving up at least a point or two or 100 or 200 basis points of growth every quarter, but we're working hard on solving that.
And last question, if I can squeeze in. Just on the aerospace, wanted to understand because last few quarters we are showing a positive growth and this quarter it has picked up. So is it largely concentrated towards defense or commercial aerospace, and within commercial aerospace, is it more towards the avionics and the maintenance overall? So can you throw some color the nature of growth which is coming within aerospace?
Yeah, I think, Karthik, let me hand that over to you on the color of growth in aerospace.
Sure, we have no thanks, Krishna Sandeep. I think what we are seeing that is, I think the aftermarket revenue which is coming back, that's what we expect the first to recover, and followed by new aircraft manufacturing that is going to come back to the previous level. So the ramp up is happening, so manufacturing engineering is the second one. And third, the avionics upgrade and working on the integrated avionics with cloud. I think some of these areas are going to be seeing the growth. And also with the electrification on mobility across aero, rail, and auto, and you'll also see that that's going to come back because sustainability is going to be critical for this whole industry. So there is an investment led by a lot of governments, and that's going to really drive the next set of growth. So the profile of growth will be a lot different than what we have lost in the last 18 months, but we are really confident that this will really start bouncing back in the next 12 months.
Okay. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikas Ahuja from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity and congrats on a decent quarter. Just one broader question I have. That is, with so much of momentum around ER&D space and most industry analysts talking about meaningful pickup in spend, Do you think maybe, next year we may see meaningful pickup in bookings or growth profiles, which could be for multiple years to follow? And we can come in line with somewhere closer to some of what your peers are reporting? Or do you think that we are still some time away from that kind of a... thank you.
Karthik, I'll let you answer that.
Yeah, no, I think because what I would really say that is some of them are secular for the next 3-4 years. For example, communication, utilities, semiconductor, automotive, medical devices, and mining. And we are seeing that I think this growth will continue for the next 2-3 years. And as far as the other segments, whether it is rail or aero, I covered in terms of what I talked about in the aero. And they need to recover back to the previous levels of 2019, which is likely to happen by 2023. And I think the real demand drivers are essentially led by what I talked about, the hyper-connectivity, the digital transformation, and the time to market, which is one of the key elements the customers realize that this is an opportunity for them to significantly reduce their time to market. In some of the cases, they are talking about 30 to 50% reduction. And that's something which is likely to continue for this entire decade. And in fact, what I would really call it as, this is going to be a decade of century as far as the engineering and R&D is concerned, and led essentially by technology transformation and with the sustainability being on the agenda and apart from the digital transformation.
All right, thank you. Just some little colors on bookings. Do you think that bookings can actually fully accelerate for maybe next year or maybe follow the current kind of a run rate? Thank you. That's about it.
Yeah, no, because I would say we'll wait for another two more quarters before we start seeing the color. And I think definitely the momentum is back and the purse is open for many of the customers, which is a good news. And need to see the size of the deals and the opportunities that are going to come onto the table. And digital is still probably small to start with, and then it becomes big. We need to see how the digital transformation is going to really start getting big.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Abhishek Shindadkar from Ingress Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. A couple of questions. The first one is on, the transportation growth on a YOY basis, and especially for the services business. Anything you could call out in terms of the weakness for that practice? Is it centered around any customer or, any comments would be helpful? The second question is on the bookings number. Now, the services bookings on a H1 basis are up 15%, and heartening to, you are doing the $120 million per quarter. Now, how much of this is, can you segregate this? How much of it is because of the change in the organization structure, because of, clients, or, recovery from the clients? What I'm trying to understand is, changes in the organization structure is whether it is reflected in the bookings number or we are yet to see that. And the third is more strategic question on the DLM piece. Krishna, with, so many, with the PLI opportunity in India and, we have a DLM business, is there a strategy where, we can capture that market? Just wanted to get your thoughts. Have we thought in that direction or, are there any conversations? Thank you for taking my question.
Karthik, I'll let you answer the first part and then I'll answer the DLM in India.
Sorry, I couldn't get your name.
Hi, this is Abhishek from InCred Capital.
Okay. So, Abhishek, I think what I would really say that is the order book is not necessarily a reflection of the structure because I think it really started coming along well. We have the right leadership in place. We are happy with the progress that we made in the last 12 months. And I think we are really trying to put the company on three specific core growth objectives. One is driving large deals, and second is driving the 5 pillars of growth that Krishna talked about. And third is about how do we really take our top 27 accounts and make them to grow disproportionately. I think that's essentially what is playing out. I will really say that I would wait for another two or three quarters before see that this is secular. But I think the structure has really played out well because there is a clear accountability in the front end and everybody is absolutely excited to really drive the growth independently. I think that really played out well so far. And I'm sorry, I missed your second question, Abhishek.
The first question, sorry, Karthik, on transport, what is the year-on-year growth is muted and what are some of the challenges that we see there?
Yeah, I think transport, I would say the aerospace is going to see about 3 to 5% growth and rail also will see around the same number. And probably we could have grown by double digit on rail and it is driven by a couple of customers' projects shifting to the right. And we hope it starts coming back by end of this financial year. And I think probably we'll see definitely a better growth for the next year to come with aero recovery in full steam and rail also starting to join the growth trajectory. And we are confident that next year will be a lot better than this year for transport.
And Abhishek, the last part of your question around BLM, see, the problem with some of the India business is we have to be very careful with the margin. You know, we've taken a very conscious call that we need BLM to be at about a 10% EBIT, where we still have a couple of, about 200 basis points to make up. Much of the India business comes at a much lower margin, and therefore we have to be very careful in terms of what we go after and what we choose to go after. I think our play has been more a global play because I think that's the only way that we will make margins that are acceptable to all of us, frankly. And therefore, our focus is not so much so on the India business. I mean, when there is a good opportunity and there is a good margin that we can make and a sustainable business, will go after it. But the idea is not to just focus on the India business because then, you know, the margins will not be something that either you or I will be happy about. And that's just the reality of the pressures that the India-based products and services do face. And therefore, we've consciously chosen to be very, very careful. I wouldn't say stay out of it, but very careful out of it. Having said that, I'll say, given the growth in some of the spend in India, like defense, for example, that's driving a lot of our global business because a global OEM, for example, has offset obligations in India and therefore would purchase a fair degree of equipment from India and therefore from us. So I would say it's a combination of we have to be, you know, focus on the right kind of business, but also focus on the global OEM sourcing from India.
That's helpful. And just a follow-up to what Karthik answered on transportation. So the right shifting of business is because of, is it because the client challenges at the client end or whether it's a fulfillment challenge at our end? I mean, or it's a combination of both. If you can just highlight that, that could be it.
Yeah, I would say about 70% is to do with the customer shipping it to the right and about 30% to do with our supply too. So I think that's where it led out to the
perfect. Thank you for taking my question and best wishes for coming.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Mukul Garg from Motilal Oswal AMC. Please go ahead.
Hi. You know, Krishna Karthik, just wanted to focus on the supply side again. This quarter, your net adds were a bit lower versus what you did in Q1, despite your attrition and utilization both picking up a bit. Is there some element of, incremental departures being higher than what they usually have been versus you guys adding up less people because of availability issues? If you can help us kind of, dissect this between these two. And if you can quantify the revenue impact in Q3 and, any potential shift, revenue impact in Q2 and potential shift to Q3 because of this.
Yeah, I think that would be difficult to quantify. Like I said, we are growing about 200 bits lower than what we would if we had a perfect supply situation. So I would still stick with that number. I think for the most part, the revenue is not lost. It's being right shifted, and therefore it is still there. But, you know, we just have to anticipate our challenge continues to be the fact that, we are hiring in newer areas, so it's taking a little bit of time to catch up. Last quarter we had net hires. I think we had about 300 people that we added net for the quarter. So yes, incrementally attrition has picked up a little bit, and there's reasons for it. But what we're also seeing is we are, ending up with net we've added people, and that will continue into Q3 and Q4. And some of the attrition challenges, because attrition challenge also is driving the net being lower than what we need or what we would like it to be. But I think some of the attrition challenges are also being addressed, and those will also mean that in Q3 and Q4 we will have a better net outcome of resources. So net, I'd say, we are giving up a little bit growth, but even for the most part, it is right shifted rather than lost. And there is a business that if we can't tackle, we are also being a little bit choosy because we also need to use this opportunity to build momentum. So we're not going after any available business, but really business that we consider strategic in the longer term.
Sure. And the second question was on the direct cost side. If you look at the direct salary cost, it was flat versus last quarter, and even on a YOY basis, it was up only 5%. And if you include the other cost and subcon as well, the YOY compare goes down to 3.5%, which is in line with the workforce addition of about 400 people, versus Q2 FY21. So, you know, how much support are you getting from the shift to offshore in your the salary cost, especially the percentage of revenue, and where else are you being able to absorb this cost? Because we have at least seen 3 merit increases over the last 1 year, so if you can just clarify that part.
Hi, I would say that the way we internally look at it, we look at the whole business on gross margin, and if you look at the charts that we have circulated, you will find there is an improvement of about 300 basis points in margin year on year. That has the complete effect of whatever has happened in terms of utilization. That has the mixed impact. I think we are doing less work on the subcontracting, and of course the reason is to be able to focus on the quality of margin. And I think that's, and of course the offshoring, where if you see year on year, we have improved by 5-6%. So, and when it comes to the merit increases, if you see that the gain that you would have in terms of offshoring possibly will take care of most of the merit increases. So the way I would look at it is net of the headwinds and tailwinds in terms of utilization, change in mix, also the impact of merit increases. Year on year, we have improved our margin by about 300 basis points. That's what I would like to comment on.
All right, so just to clarify, you are saying that the offshore shift has kind of compensated compensated for most of the merit increases over the last 1 year. And I'm just trying to dig into this because the attrition is clearly at extremely elevated levels, and you mentioned also you need to do monetary interventions to control, and that should be reflected in the direct cost. For last both the quarters, we have seen merit increases play out, but that has not really impacted your gross margins. In fact, it has improved only.
The way we look at it is not from the cost angle. I will again say that if you look at year on year, between the operational efficiency, utilization, offshoring, everything, we would have improved by 5-6%. And then the investments that we have made in terms of the increases and other headwinds, net the effect is about 3%.
Okay, sure. Thanks for answering my question.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sulabh Gowla from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good evening. Thanks for taking my question. I had a couple of questions. So first one is regarding the margin expansion this quarter. So if Ajay, if you could highlight the reason for sharp expansion in gross margins this quarter. And for the coming quarters, we understand the headwinds that are there, which is in the form of higher attrition and the intervention that you're planning for specific skill sets and travel cost increase, apart from lower billing days. So if you could also highlight what are the tailwinds which could offset some of these headwinds in the coming quarters, please.
Yes, so I would say that, from the quarter perspective, if you look at our earnings update itself, we have provided the bridge very specifically in terms of, what has happened in terms of the margin. I would say net, the expansion is on account of the operational improvement. And I'm just bringing that up. Everybody can see this, right? So if you see this in terms of the revenue mix, plus change in operational metrics, plus optimization lever, where we have let go of some, GST, some accounts which are low margin and other things. So all this adds up to about 4%, right? This is the increase that's there from the operational improvement. In terms of the headwinds, we are very clear about the 300 basis points out of that we have invested between the investments and the merit increases. And net we have improved by about 100 basis points or 97 basis points. Right? So that's what it is. The most of it is from the operational improvement. To your question about what will happen going forward, you are right, we will have a little headwind in Q3 in terms of continued same lever, as I said in the earlier comment, and what Krishna explained. I think both, if you look at this impact of merit increases as well as higher investments, I would say SG&A will not increase substantially because we have already started normal travel and some of the areas that we talked about. But in terms of merit increases, I think similar level of investment will continue. In terms of the operational improvements, we will be able to, compensate at least the merit increases. But in terms of other headwind on number of billing days and all that, next we may, the best case could be we get very close to where we are, and worst case it could be 50-75 bits reduction quarter on quarter. And then again, quarter four you get back to the normal days availability. Again, I think some part of the merit increases, investments will continue, and then we will get again the benefit of the volume and the efficiency. So I would say, as we said earlier, on the services side, between 15 and 15.5%, we will be able to sustain that margin. There are going to be a few, changes in these numbers in case of H2, A, because we are making accelerated investments for long term, and B, we have two headwinds. One is in terms of number of days in quarter three, and also the ESOP plan that the shareholders have approved, that will also take about 40-50 basis points in quarter four.
Got it. And then the other bit is on the headcount growth again. So the kind of growth that we've seen in the past couple of quarters, let's say, on the headcount bit, do you think that is enough for the kind of growth that we are envisaging for the year or for the coming quarters? And would we be comfortable in achieving the guidance with the kind of run rate that is there? So what are you assuming in terms of the additions in the next couple of quarters?
I think we have to increase our intake, and I think we're continuing to work on that. We've made the right progress. We've this quarter, after a long time, we've added meaningful number of net new additions, and not just because of freshers or anything like that. These are much of them are laterals also. So when we talk about what happens through the rest of the year, I think we're taking these things into account, and we're also maintaining a degree of prudence on the addition of manpower, because again, I till it happens, I don't want to say it has happened. Therefore, taking all this prudence into account, at the same time being sandbagging, but just being prudent. I think these are the numbers we've come up with, and we are quite confident that we'll achieve them as a minimum. And really, the idea is to do better than that. But at least let's start with the minimum of what we will achieve.
Sure. Thank you. And then one last bit as a clarification from my side on the revenue growth guidance that we've talked about. It wasn't clear to me earlier. Is it on a CC basis or a reported basis?
It's on a CC basis.
Okay. Got it. Thank you. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vivek Jain from Anand Rathi. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir. Good quarter. Two things. One, I think I heard Ajay in the opening remark. Sir, did you speak about 17% kind of margin over medium term? Is that correct?
Yes, I did say that, in the short term, our objective is to remain 15-15.5% kind of margin for the services and get back to 17% next couple of years.
17% EBIT for services.
Sorry, say that again?
17% EBIT for services. Is that so?
Services, correct. That is correct. And what will happen is between services and group, there will be about 150 bps drop because of PLM. And we think that will continue, and we won't let it be much different than that.
So 15.5% approximately for the group over a medium term. kind of a margin. And the second, sir, on the adjacent side, sir, our depreciation and the gap between EBITDA and EBIT is also a little on the higher side, while on the EBITDA side we are doing quite well. The translation to profitability or net profit is on the lower side. So is there a way where you can, given the kind of intangible assets you have on the book, is there a path wherein you can sort of reduce the D&A, or should we expect this kind of elevated D&A to continue for a few more years?
As far as the intangible assets amortization is concerned, that will purely depend on, you know, what acquisitions we do and what proportion they have of intangible assets. But in terms of the capex, I can definitely say from a level of 2.5 to 3%, we have come to a level. If you see this quarter, we have reported about 1.7% kind of capex on services side, and overall also for the group, I think we are sub 2%. I'm very sure this year we will be really tracking to that. That will also play out in the depreciation. That's my only comment. Intangible assets are absolutely dependent on which acquisitions and, you know, what composition they have in terms of goodwill and intangibles.
Right. And
Mr. Jain, I'm so sorry to interrupt. May I please request you to rejoin the question queue for your follow-up?
All done. Yes, thank you.
Waiting for the turn. Thank you so much. The next question is from the line of Neerav Dalal from Maybank Giving Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for the opportunity. A couple of questions. One, what would be our current mechanical versus embedded mix, and what would that have been over the last couple of years? And the second thing is that we've done investments in the business, which is reflecting on the G&A side. So we just wanted to understand what type of investments are these, and how should one look at that going ahead?
Karthik, do you want to take that first, the embedded versus mechanical, and how that's changed, and the second is what kind of investment?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, thanks, Krishna. I would say that I think it's about 60-40, and it's changing towards 50-50 now, in terms of the growth in embedded is far outweighs mechanical. I think that's where currently we are bullish about the growth of these five pillars. So that's definitely seen in terms of what we are looking at. Sorry, Mr. Sachin, question here.
Yeah, in terms of the investments that we've made, that is showing up in the G&A, if I'm not wrong. So I just wanted to understand what would be these investments, and how should one look at it going ahead?
Yeah, so we are definitely doubling down on digital and technology solutions area. I think as Krishna talked about, we have already onboarded a CTO, and we are definitely driving a tech solution. I think, as I said, this decade is going to be led by technology investments and solutions. I think that's where it's about people, it's about building solutions, it's about partnerships, and it's about trying to really invest in some of the customer engagements. I think it covers all of them. And the same thing is true for digital as well. I think we have definitely identified about six solutions that we want to build, which is going to be critical for our growth. And we are really making that as part of our investment strategy, and also on embedded and the networks and semiconductors. So we said we have identified those five pillars of growth, and we realized the importance of having the investments about the subject matter experts and the solution that we need to build, and as well as the partnership that we need to build. So that's where the investments are currently going.
Got that. But just on so if there are subject matter experts and so we are working on certain softwares and all of that, so we are still showing that as part of G&A and not the part of gross margins or S&M.
You are absolutely right from the perspective of the accounting. This is mainly the time and effort of the people, as you rightly pointed out. And what we are trying to do is to be able to capture it. We internally have another line item called investment. But you're right, it's all mainly people cost, effort cost, and it will all be part of SG&A, while SG&A has become SG&A and investments now.
Okay, got that. Thanks for the clarification.
Since it's at this stage of development, it doesn't have a corresponding customer, it's expensive,
okay,
and not to capitalize it or deal it in any other manner.
Got that. I got the clarification. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amit Chandra from HDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Yeah, so my question is on the on the supply side issue that is there in the market, and so we have been seeing the subcontracting cost rising across the industry, but we have been saving on the subcontracting side over the last over the last two quarters. So what is driving that, and what's the strategy here? So are we ramp of deals at the on-site location, are we not hiring subcontracting, or is it any project specific issue that is impacting this the expenses on the subcontracting side?
There's two things going on there. One is the reason why we do subcontracting is primarily not just for on-site but field work and on-site. I mean, if it's on-site design work, then we're quite we will do it ourselves. So one is structurally we've brought down the contracts where there's a lot of dependence on subcontracting, because they tend to be of a lower margin, and unless we have, if subcontracting is 80% of a project, it doesn't make sense. If it's 20%, it might still make sense, because on the design we end up making up the numbers, etc. So one is structurally we've brought down the subcontracting, and that'll that remains and that will continue. Last quarter and this quarter, we've had one or two projects where, because of the lockdowns in Australia, there hasn't been much progress on field work, and that's why that further brought it down. It will go up a little bit in the coming quarters, because some of these projects, again, we're doing those projects because there is enough engineering work, there's overall the project has a fairly good margin and something that we will, that is acceptable to us. But again, because of the lockdowns, the field work, because subcontracting is really for the field work, not for the sort of the office or the engineering work. The field work, because of lockdowns, has come down, and that has actually depressed that. But again, I want to say structurally, at one point, I think we were even at 11-12%. That won't happen again. We will remain at sort of 6-7% kind of numbers.
Okay. And sir, the second question is on the aerospace vertical. So, how has been the performance of the top client there, and how has been the ramp up in growth X of that? So if you can clarify, and is there any newer engagements that we are entering into with the top client?
Yeah, I think what Karthik had also said about aerospace, we're seeing some early signs of recovery. It's all happening on aftermarket, which is essentially to support the operations of existing fleet. That is starting to pick up, which is a good sign, because that means that traffic is starting to pick up. Of course, intercontinental traffic, the very long distance traffic, has not picked up as much and will take some more time. But actually, the way our business works, that has less dependence on us. I mean, we end up working a lot of programs which are for the single aisle, which is the short haul aircrafts. Now, that's happened. But I would say, year on year, I think we've had a bit of a growth also in aerospace. But I would say, we still are a few quarters away before we can say that aerospace is now back to, from a $30 million a quarter run rate to a $50 million a quarter run rate. I think all the green shoots are there. I mean, things are lining up. But I would say, it's still a couple of quarters away before we can say that with confidence. But I'd say, obviously, the worst is over. That is a fact. But more importantly, the green shoots have started to happen, and there will be a slow acceleration here in the next couple of quarters also.
Okay, so thanks. And best of luck for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Karan Upal from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thanks for the opportunity, sir. So just one question on margins. So we have seen a very significant shift to offshore in last few quarters. Now with the reopening of the economies in West, do you think that offshore can scale back to previous levels? And whether it will have any implications to the 15 to 15.5% service margin band in the medium term?
I think the offshore shift is structural, and I think both that's where the demand is, and that's where we've also put in a lot of effort to make sure that that happens. So we are quite confident that we will. I mean, there'll always be a little bit of swing in either direction, but we are quite confident that this is continuing. I mean, just to give you a flavor, if you look at the jobs that we're currently recruiting for, 92% of the jobs are offshore, and only 8% are on-site. At the peak, we would have even had a 25-30% would have been on-site when Our on-site was, 60% and offshore 40%. So therefore, we're quite confident that, that this will be there. And for two reasons, right? One is our reason. I think we've gotten a lot better at making sure that we're taking the right kind of business. And secondly, that's where the demand is also. I mean, structurally, demand has, what work from home has done is shown people that remote working is possible. Now, remote working, unless there is some regulatory reason, right, that is, like in aerospace, you have to have U.S. citizens on U.S. soil. But in general, for most customers, are saying if you can work from home, why does home have to be in the U.S.? Home can be in India. And I think that has been a fundamental shift, and we'll see a lot more of that going forward.
I'll just add to what Krishna said. I think when we have looked at internally in terms of our exercise of budgeting, actually we have looked at in the H2 that it will further improve. So not only it is sustainable, I think we feel that it will be another driver of improvement for our margin. And when we are looking at some of the key goals, as Krishna said, what do we need to do for profitability, there are two things with our sales teams which are being focused. One is on this offshoring, and also what we have not baked in is the conversations with the customers in terms of the pricing, because right now if you see the challenges of attrition are global in this space, and the in-house cost of our customers is also going up. So that's another area we will work in H2. We have not baked in into this commentary, but we are sure that whatever efforts we make in H2, part of it will come in H2, and that will definitely be a driver of margin improvement in the next.
Okay, sir. Just a follow-up. So you said that you further expect it to improve. So right now we are at 50-50 on-site offshore. So how much more can it improve from here on? Any color?
In our internal budget, normally we don't talk about our internal budget, but we have taken about 2-3%. That's what we have seen. Okay. But over a longer period of time, still I think there is room here.
Thanks a lot, and all the best.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraint, we take that as the last question. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments.
Thank you very much. Once again, thank you for your time and listening to this call, and for your engagement. Obviously, things continue to get much better. Like I said last time, I think we had turned a corner both from growth perspective and efficiency perspective, and we will continue to focus on that. I think there are some good things that are going on in our business at a fundamental level. We do have a challenge of supply, and we have addressed a number of those things, and we'll continue to do that. I want to assure you that things are looking quite good, and things are looking much stronger than where we were 6 or technically 12 months ago. And firstly, I'll say a big thank you to all of you for your support and confidence, without which we might not have survived the onslaught that was happening last year with where the markets were. Of course, the recovery has been good, and we also have we're also riding on that wave of recovery. But I can assure you that this time we're thinking how to make it a lot more sustainable, and not just the bounce that the market is giving us, or the bounce that is available in an immediate sector. So this time it will be a long run. We're quite confident of how things are evolving, and thank you for the support, and we'll keep engaged on how things evolve. Thank you.
Thank you very
Thank you.
Much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
On behalf of Science Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.